So who better to give that first lecture than one of her physicians? For almost two decades, Mike Iseman took care of Fern, along with many others in this room. So we asked Mike to give this lecture. So a few words about Mike. Everybody knows Mike Iseman. The giant over there holding up the building. It is really a true giant in this field. Mike Iseman is someone who has taught most anyone here who considers himself an NTM expert has crossed paths with him and has learned from him. I certainly have. He's won everything in terms of awards. So he has been recognized over and over again. One notable related to the fact that we're about to begin the American Thoracic Society, he won the Edward Livingston Trudeau Award. That is the highest honor that we provided to ATS. He has won other honors, also high honors for CHEST and other professional organizations. But if you were to ask him which one he is the most proud of, I believe it's the induction in the Rugby Hall of Fame at Princeton. But you can ask him. So Mike, I welcome you to tell us a little bit about the history of NTM and why we're here today. Thank you.
Thank you, Chuck. As one gets toward the end of one's career or one's life, you find yourself kind of taking stock and wondering, what did you do well? What might you have done better? And what were the highlights? And I must say, not in any way to denigrate others whom I've cared for, but the relationship I had with Fern and Phil Leitman really was the reason I went, or other young students who go into medicine say, I would love at some point to deal with somebody like that, to help them and have a relationship grow. So they're the best. They are the best. And we all are enriched by their lives. It is funny, there's an expression, mortals plan and the gods laugh. And that kind of describes my career. I was at Columbia doing my fellowship, pulmonary fellowship, back around 1970. And I had some terrific mentors, and I ended up working in tuberculosis. I was working on the TB program, and I got called to see a patient on the ward at Columbia Presbyterian Medical Center. She was an extraordinary case and so instructive. She was 16 years old. She lived in the Bronx. Her story was that she had had hectic, debilitating fevers for 3 weeks, and no one could figure out what was going on with her. So she arrived on the ward, and she had fevers to 105. She was anemic. Her white cell count was low. Her platelet count was low. She had lymphadenitis everywhere. Her skin had pox. It had nodules all over it. And we scratched our head. What might it be? We finally biopsied her bone marrow, and it was teeming with mycobacteria, just wall to wall. So he said, well, okay, smart guy, what are you gonna do with this? I said, call somebody. And I called all of the doctors who did ID in Manhattan to get their guidance, and got a lot of embarrassed, you might wanna try Bill over at Cornell kind of And they finally, somebody said, you should call this hospital in Denver. They do this kind of work. And so I ended up talking with Paul Davidson, who some of you may recall, Paul was my predecessor on the TB service at National Jewish. And Paul said, that's a tough one. And you might try this and the other thing. And so we fiddled around and put together a regimen that made her slowly improve. The final answer to, you know, medicine is always a mystery. Sherlock Holmes was written by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. Arthur Conan Doyle was a physician. He loved the deductive reasoning of diagnosis of a medical condition. And all of us think of ourselves as Sherlock Holmes light. And so we're scratching our noggin. And the best thing we did was we sent her down to the National Institutes of Health. And an individual named Charles Kirkpatrick, after 2 weeks, came up with the answer. She had a very rare condition, and I won't go into a great deal of detail, but as we eat and as our body goes through the normal process, lymphocytes are distributed all over the body and they travel back centrally through the thoracic duct and are dumped back in to the gut and recycle. This young girl had an unfortunate condition where she had a dilated duct, and instead of returning her lymphocytes to the circulation, it dumped them in her gut and they disappeared down her alimentary canal. So effectively, she had AIDS, sine, HIV. She had no lymphocytes to fight off the infection. And it was very gratifying that eventually we put her on medicines, changed her diet to alter the flow through her lacteals, and she got better. Not that much better, because patients who have lymphocyte deficiencies develop lymphoma, and she did just that and died. But it, in a way, was a bolt of lightning. It built in me a fascination with an organism that was making her sick. It wasn't TB. It was Mycobacterium avium. And so I started combing through the literature of Mycobacterium avium in 1971, and here I am 45 years later still trying to figure it out. And, but as Simon and Garfunkel said, what a long, strange trip it's been, but very gratifying. I do not have any financial interest to disclose, unfortunately. And the premise of my comments today, I am going to start with tuberculosis, which is the standard paradigm for mycobacterial infections. As you all know, tuberculosis has been a raging epidemic for thousands of years. And I think there's a great deal for us to learn about NTM disease as we study the history of tuberculosis, and if I don't beat the microphone senseless. The Greeks called the disease phthisis, and it meant in Greek, I actually called the classics department up at Boulder and say, how do you pronounce this word to begin with? This is, I still don't do it very well. Sound like a joke. But it meant as a form of wasting away. It was a disease that caused wasting away. By the time the Greek Empire had subsided and the Roman Empire was at its apex, they changed the designation to the Latin equivalent of consumption. The same thing, the body melts away under the attack of tuberculosis. In the modern era, the last 600 years in Europe and North America, clinicians began calling it a variety of things, the captain of all these men of death, which I'm sorry, tell me, is there a better name for a disease than the captain of all these men of death? And it was written about the consumption, and specifically to do with tuberculosis. But Oliver Wendell Holmes Sr., Junior was a lawyer, Senior was a physician, and Oliver Wendell Holmes Sr. said, this disease behaves like the white plague. Europe was just getting over this episodic, terrible outbreaks of the black plague, bubonic plague, pneumonic plague, pasteurella, and he said, we should call this disease the white plague. The striking thing about tuberculosis was that ID doctors, clinicians, for hundreds and thousands of years, recognized infectious diseases. The way they did it is that something would come to town, whether it be influenza, the black plague, cholera, typhoid, any disease, it would come, people would start to get sick, and everybody around them would soon get sick. And it was obvious, the inference is, there's something in the community, somebody gets sick and spreads the infection to somebody else. So that was the paradigm for infectious diseases. TB didn't work that way. You could have rip-roaring consumption, live with a family or work at a place for weeks and months, and individuals in contact with you didn't get sick promptly. So cause and effect, transmitted infection, really didn't apply to tuberculosis. There were all kinds of magical thoughts about what was causing TB. And microbiologists had been able to stain and see under a microscope the organisms of pneumonia or salmonella, and they could grow it. But they could never do that for the tubercle bacillus. So it remained this kind of mystery agent. Until everybody has their bias. I think one of the greatest accomplishments in all of medicine is the work that was done by a German scientist named Robert Koch. Robert Koch was a public health doctor in an area that's now East Germany, but he had an insatiable curiosity about things medical and infectious. He first was charged as a regional veterinarian public health doctor, figure out what's making all the cattle sick. And the answer was he discovered a disease called anthrax. And if you follow modern biological warfare stories and hysteria, anthrax is the agent that is most often seen as the potential agent of an infectious disease assault. But anyway, after anthrax, he moved on to tuberculosis, and in 217 days, he kept a careful diary. Using animals that he and his wife trapped on the farm, using media that he created himself, Robert Koch developed a system to stain so you could see it under a microscope and cultivate the tubercle bacillus. And it was really like somebody reached over on the wall, hit a switch, and the lights came on. We understood it was an infectious disease. Work was still to be done, however. In the early part of the 20th century, the dreams of curing infections began to really blossom. If you're familiar, vaccination, Jenner used cowpox to vaccinate against smallpox, so we were using some vaccines, but to actually have a medicine that would cure an infection came in the form of sulfa and penicillin. Sulfa was invented in Germany. It was a sad story. There was a corpsman in World War I who observed that a soldier would have a minor wound in the field, and because you couldn't control the infection associated with the wound, a minor wound would kill. So after the World War I, he went to work in one of the Germans' chemistry plants and created a medicine, Prontosil rubrum, which we now know is sulfanilamide, and it was one of the first steps. An Englishman found a mold called penicillium that produced an antibiotic that was also infectious. So we're saying, this is exciting. We may be able to treat and cure infectious diseases. And it was, I'm not sure if you believe in coincidences or they were just ready, but within a very short period of time, the medicines that finally promised to cure TB were available. I'm going to talk about NTMs in a minute, but I want to set the table with understanding the process that went on to treat a disease which is very analogous to MAC or NTM in the form of TB. Jorgen Lehmann was a Danish investigator. He was, why people have these intellectual leap of faith or inspiration that allows them to jump forward suddenly, he said, I think if I could create the paraminal salt of salicylic acid or aspirin, it might inhibit the tubercle bacillus. So in World War II raging, he was able to create the paraminal salt of salicylic acid, or PAS, and it was actually the first effective anti-TB drug ever given. Shortly thereafter, in Rutgers University in New Jersey, an emigre from Russia, Selman Waksman. Selman Waksman left Russia, but he'd grown up on the steppes of Russia, was fascinated with the organisms of the soil, and was studying soil biology at Rutgers University. And as he was culturing samples of the soil, he noticed something. I can take a spoonful of soil from over here by the oak tree, put it on a culture medium, and it inhibits the growth of other bacteria. He said, I'll bet these bugs produce something to keep other microbes out of their little half acre. So that was his intellectual logic, and he set his PhD shots to work running all over Rutgers and New Brunswick, New Jersey, bringing back samples of soil. And 1 week, Schatz says, Waksman, I think we've got something here. I was at this chicken farm, and I took some of the poop droppings from the middle of this chicken farm in New Brunswick, and I put it in a plate where I was growing tuberculosis bacilli, and it created a great zone of inhibition. Voila, they went to work, and within months, they had discovered a medicine called Streptomyces griseus, which is directly derived from chicken poop. Selman Waksman won a Nobel Prize in medicine for his discovery, even though PAS was used earlier. But during his Nobel comments, he never mentioned Schatz. He never mentioned Schatz in his written work. And Schatz eventually came around to suing Waksman and Rutgers and won his case to get some financial compensation for his work. They're still not very friendly. And then a happenstance, in 1913 in Czechoslovakia, some chemist had just, doing what chemists do, had synthesized something called isonicotinic acid hydrazide. Somebody got it off the shelf, tried it, and it was a very active drug against TB. And we had the Holy Trinity, triple therapy. And we finally, by 1950, had in our hands medication which was likely to cure virtually the great majority, if not all, cases of TB. We learned some things along the way. Perhaps the most one was when we had two drugs before INH came along. We didn't have enough streptomycin to give to every patient who had TB. So a very smart fellow at the British Medical Research Council said, let's try and do something creative here. We'll give patient number A streptomycin, we'll give patient number B PAS, and we'll give patient number C streptomycin and PAS. It was the first randomized control clinical trial. And what they observed was two drugs was substantially better than one drug. If you gave one drug, the organisms mutated and became resistant. Two drugs was better. They eventually found out three drugs was better. So from 1950 on, we lived in the era of triple therapy. The problem with that is human nature. I know you all take your pills regularly. It's not a doubt in, well, I'm not sure about that guy. Sorry. Your friend told me. That patients don't take their pills well. And we say, how could that be? I'm giving them something. Doctors do this. I'm giving you something that will cure you. Why don't you take the damn pill? I will, doc. You know, and then you go to their home 2 weeks later and there's not a pill taken. And so interrupted or abandoned treatment. But the worst thing patients did is they decided, well, that damn red pill makes me nauseated. I feel like puking every time I take it. I'll just take the white pill. So they were doing single drug therapy, and they created drug resistance. Homo sapiens. The apex of the tuberculosis epidemic in the United States occurred in 1992. We were at the end of about a 10-year surge of HIV. HIV attacks the white blood cell that's essential to TB immunity. So as HIV advances, your immune system, just like that first young girl I saw in 1971, if you don't have the white cells, you've lost the battle. And that was right at the peak of the AIDS epidemic. Everybody was saying, Chicken Little, the sky is falling. We're just in for a hell of a bad time. Case rates soared to 27,000 new cases every year in the United States. And of those cases, 10% were multi-drug resistant. And some of you kind of hear multi-drug resistant and you still say, I remember that. What it basically means, this is basketball season. If you're the Cleveland Cavaliers and you've got a team out there and this guy, what's his name? LeBron and Love, who hurt his. If your two best players fall out of the game, you're in trouble. And so with TB, when our two best players were lost to drug resistance, INH and rifampin, the job became infinitely more difficult. Having said that, over the following 20 years, we had a marvelous public health success. As you will see, cases fell from 27,000 per year to 9,000 new cases per year over 20 years, and we went from 10% multi-drug resistance to 1%. Pretty darn good. The primary tool we used was a strategy called directly observed therapy. It derives from the cynical view of human nature espoused by John Sabarbro, who is a TB controller here in Denver. San Francisco had a similar program, but it basically said, I don't trust you to take your pills, and if you don't take your pills, those nice people at your table are at risk of getting TB. So I'll tell you what. You come into my clinic Monday, and I'll give you pills. But if you miss, strike one on the chalkboard. Come in Thursday, if you miss your pills, and you don't make it Friday morning, that's strike two on the chalkboard. And damn, if you don't do it the next Monday, that's three strikes. And like baseball, you're out. Only you don't go to the bench, you go to the pokey. John Sabarbro felt that tuberculosis was such an immense public health problem that if an individual did not take the medicine, and that made him at risk of infecting people around him with a potentially lethal disease, we can do something about it. And he got the police power of the state to make that possible. Now, DOT has been embraced widely in the United States. It's part of the global program. WHO's program is DOTS, Directly Observed Therapy Short Course. It works better than the old system. It doesn't work as well as DOT does in a small community because you're looking at people spread out of over great areas and, pardon? So anyway, here we are tooting our horn, thumping our chest, celebrating the retreat of tuberculosis from the general public of America. And up pops disease due to nontuberculous mycobacteria such as M. avium, M. abscessus, M. xenopi. There are a number. What are these organisms? These are organisms which belong to the same species. They're mycobacteria. Myco means like a rod. Bacteria means, just describes that family. And these bugs were kind of around with a little background noise, but really now, as TB has receded, it is being replaced by NTM disease. Just to repeat, with tuberculosis today, we have 95% cure rates, and that's lifetime enduring cure after 6 to 9 months of therapy if you have drug susceptible organisms. We have an option of taking someone who has latent TB in their body and giving them preventive treatment and preventing the TB from emerging downstream. And since the only reservoir for treating new TB infections, this is the point I really want to make. TB has no magical reservoir other than a patient with disease. So the good news is, if we find patients who have TB, treat and cure them, or find somebody who has latent TB and might have TB next year and prevent the TB from emerging, we can really turn off the spigot of TB. And that's what's been happening. Bad news for the NTMs, our cure rates are substantially lower. What am I telling you about? Many of you who've endured frustrating repeated trips to the pharmacy to pick up another bottle of, anyway, don't get me started. And even if the patients get better, you know the story, the cat comes back. And it makes sense if you were vulnerable to Mycobacterium avium in 2008, we treat and eliminate it from your lungs, but you're in an environment where M. avium is still there. If you were vulnerable in 2008, you're vulnerable in 2015, so the possibility of reacquiring the infection is real. We have no preventive treatment. And since, unlike TB, where we treat a case and take him out of the cycle of transmission, we're not doing anything to the environmental sources, which you're going to hear about, for NTM infection. I think it's very likely that the 21st century will see the emergence of NTM infections as the new white plague. And just when you thought it was safe to go back in the water, not so fast. Thank you very much.